So after that video, you're saying, what in the world are we going to hear about today? If you're not used to hearing about Pentecost, next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday. A lot of churches, denominations celebrate Pentecost Sunday. Pentecostal churches celebrate it just a little bit differently, and we will do so today and next Sunday. I wanted to add a footnote. The reason Justin and Faith and several other families travel 45 minutes to church because they know a good thing when they come. You know, can I have an amen? That's right. The people in our church are what make our church. It's not the preaching, it's the people, and I appreciate you guys so much, and thank you. Today, if you have your notes in your bulletin, you'll want to follow along. You're not going to miss one point in today's message. I'm excited about what we're getting ready to share together this morning. I've titled the message, The Pure Language. We'll get to the reasoning behind that. You know, words connect us to God and to other people. If you ever play charades, for example, you're not supposed to say the words, you act them out and people are supposed to guess. That takes a while. Words are much quicker. If you ever try to communicate and you're not used to doing so with a person who is deaf or cannot hear, then it is also. Growing up in our church, First Assembly of God in Petersburg, Virginia, as a young fellow, we had another young fellow, Jerry Brown, and he was deaf, and we always, it was hard to communicate with him because you couldn't use words. He could read your lips sometimes if you spoke slow enough, and certainly his extended family and immediate family knew sign language, and so they could communicate with him. And if you ever have to go on vocal rest, and sometimes people who use their voice in their job, as far as pastors, have to go on vocal rest sometimes because the vocal cords get extended and can no longer speak, so they take 2 or 3 days, and they're not supposed to talk or speak, and you can feel pretty isolated if you cannot use your voice to communicate with family and friends and people around you. One man was on vocal rest for 3 days, and he couldn't speak. And on the second day, his wife said, I know you're not supposed to speak, but I have to ask, are you mad at me? And so we, you know, sometimes us guys, we don't speak, right? If we're mad at the wife, can I, don't say amen. But anyhow, we do that kind of thing. Today we want to see how important it is for you and me as a Christian to be able to speak the pure language. I want to use that term today, the pure language. And today we're going to see how important that is. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, the first part of verse 1, says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, when the day of Pentecost. Sometimes people in non-Pentecostal churches or even in Pentecostal churches, but they're not used to the Holy Spirit speaking and using that pure language in public or when people pray in private, get scared to death of the word Pentecost. Oh my goodness. And they get scared to death, maybe rightly so. I grew up in Assembly of God in Pentecost all my life. And man, I've seen some things that you don't want to see. I mean, I've seen some wild stuff out there, but I've also seen a whole lot of genuine stuff too, and people's lives changed. And that's what I want to speak to and speak about today. The word Pentecost itself simply means 50. That's all it means. The word Pentecost means 50. And the reason we call next Sunday the word Pentecost is because Pentecost happened and came on Acts chapter 2 and verse 1. That day of Pentecost had fully come, and it was precisely 50 days after Jesus was resurrected from the grave. And so we understand the day of Pentecost. And so it says when Acts chapter 2 verse 1 says when the day of Pentecost had fully come, it means the full 50 days had lapsed. Jesus had promised it would happen, and this was the day. Let me read all four verses, the first four verses of Acts 2. It says, when the day of Pentecost, once again, had fully come, and then they were all in one accord, meaning they were all together, like-minded. They weren't eating watermelon and fried chicken. They were in the upper room in one accord. That meant they had one mindset. And that mindset was to follow Christ's direction that he had given them earlier to go and tarry or wait in that upper room until something happened. And so they'd been up there praying. They didn't know what was going to happen. They'd been seeking God. Said, Lord, we know that you went to heaven. We saw your ascension into heaven. And because of that, we're obeying you. And I don't know what we're supposed to do next, but we're obeying you. And so they were all in one accord. And they were all in one place, in one room up there. And suddenly there was a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And then there appeared to them divided tongues. That means just separate tongues of fire that seemed to rest above each one of their heads. As a fire, and one sat upon each one of them. And then verse 4, and they were, some of them were filled. Is that what your Bible says? All of them, every one of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. And began to speak with other tongues. Once again, that's an interesting concept. Begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit, capital S, Holy Spirit, as the Spirit gave them the ability to utter or gave them utterance. And we see that. Tongues is the word for, we get our word glossary from in the Greek. That means language. And so they begin to speak. What they begin to speak was in different languages is what they begin to do. And let me just sort of work with this, because I know we have some people in our church that are not accustomed to speaking in tongues or the baptism of the Holy Spirit, as maybe others are. And so I want to be pretty plain and basic about this whole theological direction that God gave us. And so let me do it this way. There are three things I want to talk about. I want to talk about a pure language. I have a reason for calling it, when somebody speaks in tongues, a pure language. And number one, if you're taking notes or you're following your notes on the screen, it is, when somebody speaks in tongues, it is a language. I want to say that again. It is a language. It is not gibberish. It is not just somebody just making a lot of noise, strange noise with their mouth or their tongue, and other people going, what in the world are they talking about? It is a language, and according to the Bible, it is a language. I remember the story, and I know Rachel and my son Dallas and Jeremy Cox, a couple other people from our church, went to Evangel University in Springfield, Missouri, one of our Assembly of God colleges or universities. They have chapel services Monday through Friday during the week, and it takes place probably after the second or third class, and then it's about an hour, and then they have classes that follow that. Billy Graham was asked to speak at the chapel service one day. Certainly this has been a number of years ago. And as he spoke, he noticed, he said, and this was his testimony, he noticed the clock that he was running. He had 3 points to his message. And he noticed the clock that he just wasn't going to be able to get to that third message. And so he so eloquently ended his message or presentation or sermon on the second note and turned it over to one of the dean of men, I believe it was, who was heading up the chapel service that day. And he says as he did so, a student stood in the back and gave a message in tongues. We'll get to that in a few moments. And then another student stood and gave an interpretation to that message in tongues. And then everybody sort of worshiped for a bit. They dismissed and people went to their classes. Billy Graham was with the president of the college and some others for lunch that day in the university lunchroom. And he says, you know something, I have to tell you this. He says, I didn't have time to finish my third point in that message, but I want you to know the person who gave a message in tongues and gave an interpretation, that was my third point in which they gave that day. I don't know about you, but that's a testimony to the power of the Holy Spirit. Testimony. It says in Acts 2, 5, and 6, we read verse 1 through 4, it says, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews. Now this all happened while this group of people were in the upper room and they begin to speak in tongues. They begin to speak in a pure language. You'll see why in a moment. They begin to speak in different languages. And there were a lot of people in Jerusalem. This was the Passover. There were a lot of people in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men. And notice what it says. From every nation. They were from every nation under heaven. All of these people in Jerusalem at this time. And when this sound occurred, the multitude, the people outside, came together, and they were confused about what they heard, because not some of them, but every one of them heard them speaking in his own language. In other words, speaking in tongues is not gibberish, it is a language. And all of these people from different nations heard people in this upper room speaking their dialect, their language. They heard them, they understood them worship and praising God in this language. And because speaking in tongues is a language, no one should ever be afraid of it. No one should ever, ever be afraid of it. There's a couple of reasons why people are fearful and afraid of it. Number one, you can get into even a Pentecostal church with improper teaching. Do you know what I'm saying? Without improper teaching, we go astray and we can really allow things to get out of hand. And I'll explain why that is so important. I'm going to do a lot of things in a moment, but I'm sharing with you. But I think it's also understandable that the Holy Spirit is certainly a perfect gentleman, and we don't need to have that fear. Let me just sort of do it this way, and that is share with you three myths about this pure language or speaking in tongues. Number one, you don't start speaking it fluently the first day when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit or you receive it. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. I want to use that word again. It is you and the Holy Spirit cooperating together. The Holy Spirit doesn't come on you and take over your body, and that includes your tongue. You have to yield your tongue to the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 6 and verse 13 says, and this is the Apostle Paul, and he's talking about all the members, not just our tongue, but all the members of our body. He says, don't yield the members of your body to unrighteousness or sinful things, but you have a choice. Notice that word. You have ability, you have a choice to yield your bodies as instruments of righteousness. In other words, what you look at, how you talk, where you go, all the things that are included in living life. He says these are choices that believers have, and it takes time to learn how to speak. Notice the word I use, learn. It takes time to learn how to speak the pure language fluently. It takes time. And you say, well, you know, what if I don't speak it right? I'm praying to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Maybe I have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I begin to pray in that heavenly language, that pure language. I begin to pray in tongues, and I don't get it right. I want you to know something, that rarely have any of us got it right to begin with. It's all a learning process. Can I have an amen? It's a learning process for every person who is filled with the Holy Spirit. And as we begin to pray in tongues, we will get accustoming, and the Holy Spirit will flow through us. And if you want to pray in a prayer language to God, I've got news for you. You can. You can do so. If you want to, you can do so. The Holy Spirit never, ever forces himself on somebody. I've heard and seen people say, well, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me, and the Holy Spirit can do whatever he wants, but I also know the Holy Spirit is a perfect gentleman. He's the third person of the Trinity, and he loves you and me, and he wants to work to your good and my good in our life whenever and whatever he does. And it may not be fluent the first day. You're learning that pure language. And when somebody is filled with the Holy Spirit, I want to say this. Sometimes people who are brought up in Pentecost, they say, well, you know, I was baptized in the Holy Spirit when I was 12 years old. Well, I was baptized in the Holy Spirit when I was 12 years old as well. But listen, it's not about when you were baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's all about, are you still flowing? Is the Holy Spirit still flowing today through you? You can have been baptized in the Holy Spirit a long time ago. You can have spoken that pure language, heavenly language. You can have spoken in tongues. But guess what? Guess what? God is not into earmarks of your life. Okay, I got saved. Cross that off. Okay, I got filled with the Spirit. Cross that off. That's not what God is really all about. God wants to baptize you and me in the Holy Spirit, and then every day of our life, He wants us to have a fresh, new infilling of the Holy Spirit every single day of our life. And if you don't do that, then you'll walk around with sort of like, you know, this thing on your shoulder about, yeah, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, and it's sort of like a proud thing and a badge of honor. It's not about that. It's all about the power of the Holy Spirit flowing through you today, quickening you, touching you, making Himself so real to you that it's an amazing thing that happens. Let me deal with a second myth. I think a second myth would certainly be, you can't control it. And some people say, well, when the Holy Spirit baptizes you, you just lose all control. I just want to go on record as saying that's not the same Holy Spirit that I read about in God's Word whatsoever. And this is the myth. You kind of go into a trance and you start speaking in tongues. It doesn't happen that way. I think a lot of people are afraid of it because here's what they think. They think, you know, one day I've been praying to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and one day I'm going to be shopping in Target. You know where I'm going with this, anybody? And then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit's going to come on me, and I'm going to grab that mic for the PA system, and I'm just going to go to town in Target. I want you to know that's not going to happen. Let me ask you this. How about the other gifts of the Spirit? There are gifts of teaching as well. There's a gift of teaching. Certain people have gifts of singing. Some people have gifts of teaching. Let me ask you this. If you have the gift of teaching, can you control that gift of teaching? Sure you can. You don't just stand up anywhere you are and say, hey, I've got the gift of teaching, so here it goes. I'm going to teach whoever's in front of me. Can you control the gift? And it's different than the pure prayer language or praying in tongues, but publicly or in prayer meetings sometimes or in other group settings, you'll have somebody give a message in tongues and interpretation in that service. And can you control that gift of tongues and interpretation? Sure, you can control it. And I'm going to beg Joyce's forgiveness after the service today. But anyhow, before the service, and I do it because I know she's already forgiven me. But nevertheless, a couple of weeks ago, Joyce Call allowed the Holy Spirit to use her in a message in tongues, if you were here, and also interpretation. Did you know that she just didn't start speaking out in tongues in the middle of our songs and worship service? Did anybody notice that? I wasn't up here praying, and all of a sudden she just broke out in the middle, and in the middle of my prayer just did that. But she waited till an appropriate time. Now, during the worship service, she probably, as I many times do, I sense the Holy Spirit wants to use me, wants to speak. And I'm saying, Lord, okay, I need you to give me the appropriate moment, the appropriate time. That's what she did in that service. And she sensed it, but she controlled herself and waited to that appropriate time. That's the way the Holy Spirit works. And the same way you can control it is also the same way that you can control not praying in tongues and not being used in the Spirit when you need to be used in the Spirit. I said last week, I believe, a week before, I use my mother-in-law so much that she's going to be my best friend when I get to heaven. But nevertheless, I remember in several services as we grew in Petersburg, Virginia, and planted a church in Colonial Heights, Virginia, that she would say, and you know, I was friends with my wife's brother, so I'd go over to their house for Sunday lunch. She always fixed a big meal. I had more than one reason for going over with my wife's brothers, but anyhow, we'll leave that as it is. And we go over, and sometimes she would sit around the table, and we would pray the blessing, and she would know something. She said, I have something I need to confess, and to the whole family. She had a big family. And the question was, this morning during the service, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and wanted me to give a message in tongues and or wanted me to interpret. And I was just fearful of doing it. I just was just fearful of doing it, Fred. I may be out of order in the service. And so I just sort of quenched that. Do you know what I'm talking about? I just quenched that and just didn't give it. And now after the service, I feel the Holy Spirit saying, you know, you failed to do that. Next time, you know, we need to ask forgiveness for that and do it. Sometimes in a public service, if somebody fails to do it, the Holy Spirit wants to get the message across so much, he'll use somebody else to do that as well. And that can and certainly does happen in public worship services. And certainly, here's what we read from Paul, 1 Corinthians 14:32. It says, and the spirits of the prophets, in other words, the person who is speaking in tongues, are subject to the prophet. Do you know what I'm saying? The spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. It's not like the Holy Spirit is making you. It is subject, control. The prophet or the person speaking is able to control what they're sharing in a message in tongues. There's no forcing whatsoever by the Holy Spirit. Let me give you a third myth, and then we'll get on to the other three. And that is, somebody will say, I'm afraid the Holy Spirit's just going to jump on me one day and uncontrollably. It's going to be, and so I'm afraid of it. I've heard some negative things about it, or I've never really heard any teaching about it. The church I went to before never talked about the Holy Spirit in the way you're talking about it today, and so I'm fearful of it. And I don't want to mock something here, but that would be saying like the Holy Spirit is just going to jump on you somewhere. You know, some people have the gift of giving. Do you know what I'm talking about? Sometimes people blesses people so much financially, he gives them a gift of giving and blessing other people through that gift of giving. And I don't want to mock anything here, but saying the Holy Spirit's going to jump on you would be like saying when you pass the offering bag, then that $20 bill just jumped out of your wallet. And because you have a gift of giving, it jumped into that bag and you didn't have any control over what you wanted to give. It was just all of a sudden happened. The gifts of the Spirit don't work that way. They simply don't happen that way. And in order to pray in the pure language, you're going to have to be in an attitude of prayer, not in Target shopping. Can I have an amen? You're going to have to be in an attitude of prayer, seeking God. And it's not a frivolous thing. The message in tongues, and sometimes you can pray in tongues going down the road. You can pray certainly in tongues in your own bedroom and not just in church for sure. And we'll talk about why we do that. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1 said they were in all in one accord. Remember that word. I ran out of oxygen. Remember that word. They were all in one accord. That's not a Honda Accord they were in. They were all together in one place, and they were praying and expecting what Jesus had promised. And this is what Jesus had promised in Luke 24. He said, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. In other words, Jesus told them before his ascension, I'm going to send you the power of the Holy Spirit, but here's what you need to do. But tarry, that's another word for wait and pray, tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. So the disciples had been with Jesus. He had ascended. And then they said, okay, we need to do what Jesus told us to do. We're going to the upper room and we're going to pray and wait and tarry. And they didn't know what to expect. But they said, Lord, whatever you have in store for us, we want that. And the Holy Spirit will flow through you if you're in an attitude of prayer. Can I have an amen? So are we on the same page that is not something, the Holy Spirit is not somebody that you need to be fearful of whatsoever. The Holy Spirit is your paraclete. He is called alongside of you to help you and never to hinder you, never to scare you whatsoever. And so we're back to three things about this pure language called speaking in tongues. We've talked about it is a language. And then secondly, it is the language of the Holy Spirit. It is the language of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 14:2 says, for he who speaks in a tongue, and he's talking about speaking in tongues, for he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. And I think we understand that. For no one understands him. When somebody is speaking in tongues, other people don't understand what they are saying. But here's what we do understand, the Bible says. We understand that God is present. You may say, well, why do people stand in a public worship service and give a message in tongues and then somebody interprets it? Why doesn't God just use somebody in a message of prophecy? And he does. He uses me in a message, a gift of prophecy sometimes while I'm preaching. I will sense that and it'll just flow from me. It's in English so that we can understand it. But why doesn't God always do that? The Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the same Holy Spirit, he says this is the reason why, because there may be unbelievers in your service. There may be people in your service that are not accustomed to the power and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And when somebody gives a message in tongues, immediately it draws their attention. And they say, God must be present in this place. When a person is used in a true gift of the Spirit, then what happens is there's a holy awe in the place. You ever notice that? There's an awe in the place. The music stops. Everybody, and we listen to that because God is speaking to His people. And it's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. You say, well, can't somebody just make that up? Oh, yeah, they can. But that's the reason that you were given a pastor to head that service up. Because I have been in services where somebody came in the door during the service time, a husband and wife, and the husband, he came all the way up front with his briefcase, and the wife came in a little bit later seated in the back. We had never seen them before. And the message during the service, she stood up and gave quote-unquote a message in tongues, and then the husband was getting ready to interpret it. Listen, if you're in tune with the Holy Spirit, you can tell right away that somebody's message in tongues is not right, that something is wrong, it is shrill, it is off base. It's just, you don't understand it with your English, but you just know that. And as a pastor, my job is not just to preach on Sunday morning. My job is to discern that kind of thing and to stop it right there. And in that particular service, I wasn't the pastor. That particular service, the pastor immediately just walked down to the gentleman, put his hands on both his shoulders, and said, sir, would you just sit down and we'll talk after the service, and just stopped whatever he was saying and then went on with the service. And as we do that, we learn that any time that there's truth, there can always be error. Do you know what I'm talking about? And so we need to know what's happening. And aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit is in control of every service? I don't know about you, but I'm glad of that. And He knows what He is doing. Give the Lord praise today. So Paul said, for he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God, for no one understands him. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. In other words, we don't know what he's talking about, but the Holy Spirit knows, and God the Father understands and knows. And so when one speaks in a tongue, he speaks in the Spirit. Paul goes on to say in verse 14 and 15, if I pray, notice the words, when I am forced to pray, is that what Paul said, if I pray in the Spirit? No, if I pray. It's always a choice to pray in tongues. It is always a choice. And this is what Paul said. He said, if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. Anytime I am praying in a gift in tongues, in that pure language, I really have no idea what I'm saying or talking about. But listen to this. The Holy Spirit will lay on your heart a need. And it can be any need whatsoever. I'm praying for my brother-in-law. He needs healing. And I may begin to start in English, Lord, heal my brother-in-law. I pray that you work in his life in a tremendous way and just bring, you know, precisely what he needs. That's the best of my English ability to pray to God and ask him to work in my brother-in-law's life. But God knows more about my brother-in-law's life than I know. And the Holy Spirit will then begin to allow me to pray in that pure language to God for my brother-in-law. I don't really precisely know everything I'm saying, but listen to this. My spirit identifies with what my spirit is praying, that I'm praying to God Himself. And the Holy Spirit will pray through me to God the Father according to what God wants to do in my brother-in-law's life. It is that amazing prayer. And so it says in verse 15, what is the conclusion here? I will pray with the Spirit. In other words, I will pray in tongues, and I will pray with understanding. So for the Christian who has been baptized in the Holy Spirit, we should pray with our understanding, but we should also pray in the Spirit. That's what Paul, I didn't say that. That's what the Bible says. That's what the Apostle Paul says here. With the language I speak and understand. He also says, I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. Most of the time in our worship services, we sing with the understanding. The English words are up there, and we're singing those words. But how many of you, I know I have very often been in services where the Holy Spirit just begins to move. And all of a sudden you begin to sing in that pure language, that heavenly language in tongues. Everybody just begins to sing together. And if you haven't been in that situation, that is a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing that you've missed. And I pray God continues to visitate our services with even more of that. So if I pray or sing in tongues, my spirit is praying. My spirit is singing. So the Holy Spirit will rise up within you as you read the Word of God. I don't know about you, but I read my daily devotions, and then all of a sudden sometimes, not every time, but sometimes I can be reading God's Word, and man, all of a sudden what I've been dealing with or going through or praying with somebody for, the Holy Spirit will cause that Word to come alive right there, and all of a sudden you just back off and begin to let the heavenly language just flow, because it's God making sync with your spirit right there. It's a wonderful thing. You pray to God, you sing a worship to God. And how about this? I want to interject this. I think it is so important. How many people only pray with their understanding? Now, you know where I'm going. How many people, even believers in Pentecostal churches, Assembly of God churches, only pray with their understanding? They never pray in the Spirit. Could not a lot of our prayers never be answered? You know exactly where I'm going, because we're not praying in the Spirit. When you pray in English, you're very, very limited to what your knowledge is really all about. Every believer needs to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and every believer needs to use the pure language of praying to God in the Spirit, praying to God. Here's what Paul said. Likewise, in Romans 8, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness. What is my weakness? My weakness is I don't know everything about the need at hand that I'm praying for. That is my weakness. That's what Paul said. The next verse tells us that. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. I know I should pray for my brother-in-law, perhaps, but I don't know how I should be totally praying for him. What does he need? I think they need this, but the Holy Spirit knows everything that he needs. And so the Spirit helps me in my weakness, for I don't know what I should pray for as I ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us. Aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit comes along and prays with us and for us when we don't know how to pray? The Holy Spirit will pray for us with groanings which cannot be uttered or cannot be understood. So the ministry of prayer is a spiritual ministry, and that's why we need the help of the Holy Spirit, because we cannot know everything that we should pray for. And think about it this way. We are trichotomous, right? According to the Trinity is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You and I were created in the image of God, so we are trichotomous as well. We are body and soul and spirit, and our soul is our will, our mind, and our emotions. That is what our soul is made of. When we pray in English, we're praying out of our soul to God. When you pray in tongues, you're praying out of your spirit to God. I want to say that again. When you pray in English, you're praying out of your soul to God. When you pray in the Spirit, you're praying in tongues, you're praying out of your spirit to God, and He wants to help us in our weakness. And also, He knows the mind of God. So when the Holy Spirit, when we speak and pray in that pure language, we're praying according to the will and the plan of God for that need. Everybody with me today, we're praying according to that plan and will of God. I'm going to ask my wife, she'll cut her mic on this morning and share just a little bit of a testimony about how the Holy Spirit prays through us in amazing, amazing ways. She's going to share that this morning.
I was just going to share about my mother-in-law when she was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. I guess Travis, I think, was a year old at the time, and I had gone through a surgical procedure. And I had come home from the hospital that day, and I'm considered a free bleeder. And those of you who know, I experienced that a couple of months ago with something I went through. But that day I came home, and I went through it again. And it was on a Wednesday night. My husband was an associate pastor at a church, and he was supposed to be getting ready to go to church that night. And all of a sudden I had this severe case of bleeding really bad, and my parents had already left to go to church, and my husband was leaving to go, and I called my husband and said, you've got to you can't go to church. I got to have help. I think you got to take me back to a hospital. The bleeding is tremendous. And I said, call your mom, because his mother was a praying woman, just like my mother was. And I didn't want to bother my mother. She had already gone to church. I said, call your mom. I knew she could maybe not pray for me and with words, but his mother was the type of woman that when she prayed, I knew she'd pray in the spirit. She came over. I'll never forget it. She came over and she came. I was laying in the bed because I was bleeding pretty bad at that moment. And I remember she walked into the bedroom. She came over to me. She just put her hand on me and she began just speaking in other tongues, praying over me. And I immediately felt the blood just stopped. It just stopped. And I looked at my husband, I'll never forget, and he was still at the house. He had not left to go to church. And I looked at him and I went, it stopped. I felt it. It stopped. And they got up, they helped me take the bandages off, and we checked it out, and it had totally stopped. And I mean, he had called the doctor and he said, if it continues, you know, you have to bring her on in. But that showed me that night that, you know, she prayed in tongues, but it was a power I felt that God, it was a healing word that she prayed over me, and I felt that God had used that to heal me. And here she had no way of knowing what she was praying, because I don't believe that she had the words to pray in English anyway, even at that time. But we have a praying God. She knew that I needed prayer, and I thought that was, to this day, I think of her, of how God used her, and I just think it's amazing. So we do need our heavenly prayer language, that's for sure.
Yes, good. Great. Amen. See, I had prayed for my wife out of my soul. I prayed for her in English. My mother-in-law came in. She prayed out of her spirit. She prayed in tongues, and God heard that, praying according to the will of God. Isn't that amazing when you begin to look at all the needs that we have? And we've been praying for things forever and ever. Let me ask you a question. When is the last time you prayed in that pure language about that particular need? When you pray in the pure language, the Holy Spirit prays through you according to the perfect will of God. And I don't know about you, but that's the best way to get any prayer answered and see God come through in power. You know, we actually have two intercessors. We have Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 8, verse 34 says, Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He is forever making intercession for you. He's praying for you and me and the needs that we have. But we also have another intercessor, and that's the Holy Spirit. He wants to pray in us and through us according to that same perfect will of God and see those prayers answered as well. They work together, seeing your prayers answered. Jesus in heaven, the Holy Spirit on earth. Here's what the Apostle Paul, and some people have said, well, I don't know about that speaking in tongues. I believe I'm filled with the Spirit. I don't need to do that. I believe, you know, I'm just as good as God wants me to be kind of thing. Here's what the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 5. I wish you all spoke with tongues. I wish you all spoke. That's what he said. And skipping on down to verse 18, he said, I thank my God I speak in tongues. Now, this is the Apostle Paul. I thank my God I speak in tongues more than you all. He said, this is the direction that the church needs to go. And he said, even the Apostle Paul, but he gave a note of caution as well in 1 Corinthians 14, 39. He says, do not forbid them to speak with tongues. I know entire denominations and churches who forbid people to speak in tongues. I know churches who have publicly said that speaking in tongues is of the devil. It's demonic. I cannot put it together how God would put something in His Word for us to be involved in and to practice and call it demonic. I just don't understand that. It just beats me. I can't comprehend that. And some even teach that kind of thing. The pure language of speaking in tongues is the Spirit's way of praying and edifying our Heavenly Father and also praying according to the perfect will of God. So when one receives the baptism of the Holy Spirit And that's going to be my topic next Sunday. You'll not want to miss it. When one receives the baptism in the Holy Spirit, then certainly you're not forced to do anything. The Holy Spirit won't force you to speak in that pure language. It's a cooperative effort between you and the Holy Spirit together, edifying God and praying in the Spirit. You yield your tongue to the Holy Spirit. You pray and start speaking, and then He just allows, He'll move through you, take over, and it'll become as you continue every day to speak in that heavenly language to God. Somebody said, well, shouldn't I feel something before I can pray in tongues? I think I need to feel goosebumps or something before I can pray in tongues. Let me ask you a question. Do you always feel goosebumps when you pray in English? I know I don't. A lot of my prayers, I have to pray by faith. I don't feel anything. I've got to say, Lord, this is a difficult time for me. This is a rough season for me, and I don't even feel like praying, but I know it's what I need to do, and I pray by faith. And sometimes we are allowed to be using that heavenly prayer language to God by faith, not always feeling something all the time. When I tithe, I don't know about you, I don't feel something. I do it by faith when I tithe and give to God. And here's how it works in me. I'll just be praying in English, and then that pure language will just flow. Let me say this. The more and more often you allow that pure language to be a part of your life, the easier it'll be for you to pray in tongues and pray according to the will of God. So did you know that praying in your spirit is part of the armor of God? We believe in the armor of God. Here's what Paul said in Ephesians 6. He said, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And notice verse 18, praying always with all prayers and supplications in English. Is that what it said? No, praying in the Spirit, part of the armor of God. Praying always in the Spirit. Here's what he said in Ephesians 6:18, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kind of prayers and requests. Pray in the Spirit. Here's what it says in Jude chapter 20. But you, beloved, build yourselves up in the most holy faith. And how do you build yourself up? Praying in the Spirit. That's how we do it. We pray in the Spirit. All through the New Testament, we're encouraged to pray in the Spirit. Pray in that pure language, the heavenly language. So, is it possible that you're losing some spiritual battles? Sometimes Christians will say, you know, I've been praying and it seems like the devil's on my back and nothing's working out. My next question would be, are you filled with the Holy Spirit? If you are, are you praying in that pure language, the Spirit language to God? Because you're losing a lot of spiritual battles if you're not praying in that heavenly language. And then secondly, if you're not praying in that heavenly language as well, then a lot of your prayers are not being answered. It will have to be people of the Spirit. He whom the Son sets free is free indeed. That's the power of the Holy Spirit in our life. And certainly, let me look at number three. It is also a pure language, and that's the title of my message. Speaking in tongues is a pure language. I didn't put this in your notes, but you may want to go back to Genesis 11, verse 1. Genesis 11, verse 1, I'll read it for you. It says, remember this, it says, now the whole earth, this is at the Tower of Babel. Now the whole earth had one language. Notice where I'm going here. The whole earth, every nation, had one language and one speech. They all had one language and one speech. I don't think it was Hebrew, because it wasn't until Genesis chapter 12, the next chapter, that God called Abraham and the Hebrew nation began. So the whole language on earth wasn't Hebrew. And I don't know about you, but I don't think it was English. Can I have an amen? I don't think it was English. So is it possible that the one language that everyone spoke was the pure language, the heavenly language of heaven? Listen, God put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And what does the Bible say He did with Adam and Eve? Every day He came down to the garden and He walked. And what else did He do? He talked with him. They had a language. They communicated together. They had a language. And I suggest that all three of them spoke in a pure language, a heavenly language. And here's what it says in Genesis 11. It says, but the Lord, this was at the Tower of Babel, but the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the Son of Man had built. And the Lord said, indeed, the people are one. That sort of sounds like the upper room in one accord. Remember that. All the people are one, and they all have many languages. Is that what your Bible says? They all had one language. Every nation spoke one language. And this is what they began to do, build this tower. And notice, this is God speaking. Now, nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Why would nothing that they propose to do be withheld? Because they spoke the pure language of heaven like you and I do when we speak in tongues and pray in that pure language. Nothing will be impossible. And let's go on to say in verse 7, come, let us. That's a capital U for us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Trinity is talking to each other. And they said, let's all three of us go down to earth and see. Let us go down there and do something. Confuse their language. In other words, they're all speaking this one language. Let's go down and confuse their language that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth. And they cease building the city. Therefore, verse 9, the name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the whole earth. And so we certainly see this pure language that the whole world spoke and God understood ever since Adam and Eve were created in the Garden of Eden. And because you pray spiritual prayers, not soulish prayers, God will hear them. It's a powerful thing. Nothing will be withheld. Notice what God said. Now that they begin to do this, nothing will be withheld. I want you to know that when you pray in tongues, when you use the pure language, you're praying according to the Spirit of God. And the Bible says nothing will be withheld from you when you pray that pure language from God. It is a powerful thing to do. You see, our soul, what we understand with our English language, our soul wants to pray, and it wants to pray selfish prayers for ourself and our children and our finances. They go something like this. God, bless my kids today. Keep them all safe in school. Bless me today. Take care of all of my finances. Help me to meet all my bills. If I'm sick, I want you to heal me. In other words, it's a lot of I want. I think this is the best thing in the world. They tend to be, not always, but tend to be selfish. But here's the difference when you pray in tongues and you're praying according to the Spirit, you pray God's plan for your life, your marriage, your children, your sickness. It may not be God's plan to heal you today or tomorrow from that sickness. Paul said he prayed at least 3 times, remove this thorn in the flesh from me. And God says, you keep holding on because that's not my plan. You see, Paul said, I prayed in tongues more than you all. Do you think that Paul prayed in tongues about that thorn in the flesh? I have a feeling that he did, and on many, many occasions, but God never removed that thorn in the flesh from him whatsoever. So the people in Genesis 11 have one language. God takes that one language away and gives them different languages, and we have all, from that point, all the languages of the world today, some 6,500 languages in our world today. But we have to come to Zephaniah 3, verse 9. As I conclude, Zephaniah 3 and verse 9, it says it this way. For then, he's talking about when Jesus comes back, we're all looking for him. This is a prophecy. When he comes back and brings his kingdom back to earth, notice what he's going to do. For then I will do what? Restore. What does the word restore mean? Bring back something that used to be, and you're going to restore it. If you have an old classic car, a 70 Chevelle Super Sport with a 454 and blah, blah, blah. If you have that and it's rusty and things are falling apart, you know, for the right money, they can restore that car back to what it used to look like when it was showroom condition. This is what God said. And that day I will restore to the peoples a pure language. That sounds like the language from Genesis 1 all the way to Genesis 11. He says that they may call, what is call on the name of the Lord? That means pray to him, to serve him with what? That one accord. I think I read that over in Acts chapter 2 somewhere, that they would also be in one accord in the upper room as they were praying in the Holy Spirit. God is saying, I'm going to give back to the people of every language their pure language that I took away in Genesis chapter 11, so that nothing they propose to do will be impossible for them. Do you see the power in praying in the Spirit? What God has said, when we pray in the Spirit, it's a powerful thing, and God will bring. There are 6,500 languages in the world today, and there's only one language that doesn't have any profanity to it, and it's the pure language that we're talking about today. Give God praise for that. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing today. There's only one language, and it's pure. There's only one language that has no profanity, and God says, I'm going to give that language back to my people. But until that day, you and I can be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and we can speak in that pure language to God in our private prayer life, no matter where we are. And if you're saying, Pastor, I don't know how to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, what we're going to do when we end the service today, we're going to have people come and just stand across the front who say, Pastor, I don't understand it. Listen, the people in the upper room, they had no clue what the Holy Spirit was really all about. They just said, if God says I need it, then I want it in my life. And so we're going to pray for people at the altar in a few moments. And as we do so, other people who, if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, I want you to come and stand behind them. We're going to pray for them. Worship team will be leading us in a song during that time. But also, you know, you may be filled with the Holy Spirit right here. I've seen God do it in wonderful ways. But there are other times when I've prayed for the Holy Spirit baptism and I wasn't filled. And during the week at home, praying by my bedside, praying, and usually it's always alone. You're seeking God. Lord, I need to be filled with your Holy Spirit because I want to be used by you to pray according to the perfect will of God. I want to be used by you to be able to glorify the Father in that pure language that one day every nation and every tongue will speak once again as they did back in Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 11. I want to do that today. I want to be used in that. And you know something? It's amazing. If you just begin to pray, Lord, I love you. I thank you. I worship you. Do it aloud and let your tongue move. Sometimes people pray silently to God. Nothing wrong with that. But if you want to be used in that heavenly prayer language, you've got to open your mouth and you've got to let your tongue move just a little bit. And that simply means, Lord, I love you. And aloud, Lord, I thank you today. I just worship you. I thank you for what you do. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I know it's a promise that you've given every single believer, and we want to be filled. We've seen people filled with the Spirit, and the joy of the Lord becomes a strength in a mighty powerful way. I need more of my prayers answered, and so, Lord, just fill me. And just make that a consistent prayer. Don't do it one day and then take a week off. I mean, if you're serious about it, as God is, make it a consistent part of your prayer, and then you know what you're going to do? You're going to come into church one Sunday morning and go, Pastor, I've got something I got to tell you. And I can see the illumination all over your face. And I say, I know exactly what you're going to tell me. God has filled you with His Holy Spirit. And it's been a wonderful thing. And I'll say, where did you get filled at? Well, I was at my home. I was sitting in the living room. I was reading my Bible. I was in my bedroom praying. And I just began to worship God. I had a worship song on maybe. And I began to worship Him. Thank you, Lord. And, you know, God inhabits the praise of His people. And when you begin to praise Him, then the Holy Spirit wants to fill you. And it's amazing what God can do. I believe in so many people's lives today, so many Christians' lives today, the reason that they're not satisfied and happy with their Christian life is they're not filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Would you stand with me this morning? Our worship team is coming today. Stand with me today. Let's just take a moment. I love you today, Lord. I thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. The gift of the Holy Spirit is as real as God the Father is and Jesus dying on the cross for my sin. And the Holy Spirit is here. God the Father is in heaven. Jesus is not here. He is seated at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. But He has sent the Comforter. He sent the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is here with you and me. He lives in us as a believer. And He wants to swell up in our life and fill us with the precious Holy Spirit. And I'm not putting anybody on the spot today. I want you to be sincere. I want you to be honest today. But if you say, Pastor, I need to be filled with that precious Holy Spirit, I want God to pray. pray through me. I want the Holy Spirit to pray through me in that pure language, that heavenly language. And I just want to pray with you right here. We're not going to embarrass you. Nobody's going to do anything to you. It's a time of commitment to God to fill you with the Holy Spirit. If that's the case, would you just come right now and just come and stand right across in front of me right here. I'm just going to wait just a few moments. Come and stand right here, just shoulder to shoulder, not front and back, but shoulder to shoulder across the front. Just step a little bit closer to me if you would. And then others who are filled with the Holy Spirit, and this is how we're going to conclude our service today, would you come and put a hand on their shoulder? If you're filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you have a fresh anointing on your life, would you come and just put a hand on their shoulder and pray with them today? I'm just going to wait for people to come. This is Assembly of God Church. It's a Pentecostal church. I believe there are people here that are filled with the Holy Spirit, and I believe I need you here today to pray with people. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, I need you to pray with people at this altar. Our worship team is going to lead us as we just pray with people today. Pray with people. Lord, we love you.